third of February last year, the Lord gave me a scripture, and I was praying over my life. I was at a prophetic event, and I sat in a chair, and somebody came to pray with me, and they gave me this simple verse that says, "I have called you to open the ancient gates." Now, I saw that this morning as I was going through my preparation. I've called you to open the ancient gates. And last week, when I spoke on Psalm 24, I felt like the Lord literally opened me up, you know? And it's like, as you draw close to the things that God has called you to do, you can't help but overflow with what He's given you. And so I now understand better what happened to me last week. It's because I was preaching something that was spoken over my life. And you know what? I think I lost it a little bit. But it's okay. I'm okay. But listen to what he said. The doors of oppression, the treasure hidden from my people, the mystery of my love, I will open the door. I will open the door to you, and I will sup with you. I will reveal to you all the books that have been written and the scrolls that are opened. I'm going to break the seals on that which was hidden. You know, God has given us a vision for the church. And vision in the Bible is not like vision in the world. Vision means revelation. God reveals, He opens the seals on the scrolls, and He literally rolls open the broken seal, and He opens the scroll for us to see what is written. God has got a plan for us. God has got a plan for you. So He says, tell my children that I'm breaking the seals, and they will receive hope. God is going to impart hope to us. God is already imparting hope to us. And so on February last year, He says, the first gate is my gate, for I am the gate. I am the delight, I am the door, I am the way. I have forged it in suffering, and I have covered it with my death. But if you go through it, you will have access. You will have access to me, you will have access to my love, you will have the hope and the confidence I have in you. Fear will be gone. You will be reminded of who you are. Yes, a child of God. So come. The Lord says, come to me. One of the favorite brilliant prayers we like to pray is, Holy Spirit, come. And on Friday, the Lord said to me, there's a time for you to pray that prayer, right? And when your people gather, when my people gather, call upon my name, and I will come. But He says, when the corporate gathering is over, then it's my turn to call you. And He says, come to me. Come to me. And come and see that I am good. Come and taste and see that I am good. And then I'll just note a little silent here. And maybe I'll remind you. Be you. Be you. The world will adjust. I think there's far too many people in the world today trying to adjust. Don't try to be something else. Be you. Let the world adjust to you. Don't you adjust to the world. I love the diversity and the extreme that I have given this church. It's a palate, a taste. It's a natural tasting thing for us to want to see God move and flow and bring and do new things. And He says this, and I'm going to just quote the scripture. Man will always look on the outside, but I look into your heart. And yes, I'm quoting from 1 Samuel 16 now. interested in how you look on the outside. He knows that about you. Whilst you're outside in faith, your inside growing strength. I look to your heart. I look into you. I see into you. And I see into you. Into you I see is what intimacy is. Into me I see. So God wants you to look beyond your abilities and your outer strengths. But he says, the time is coming when the music fades and everything has been sung for you to come to me, the author and the perfecter of your faith. So come, let us be determined to come to the Lord. Let us do whatever it takes to get to the place where he draws near to us, because our hearts are leaning towards him. So the scripture I want to read this morning comes from the first book of the Bible in Genesis. It says, then his father Isaac said to him, please come close and kiss me, my son. So he came close and kissed him. And when he smelled the smell of his garments, he blessed him and said, see, the smell of my son is like the smell of feet which the Lord has blessed. Now may God give you the dew of heaven and the fatness of the earth and an abundance of grain and new wine. May peoples serve you. May nations bow down to you. Be the master of your brothers, and may your mother's sons bow down to you. Cursed be those who curse you, and blessed be those who bless you. It's an amazing moment between a father and a son. Except if you knew the context. You see, this context of this beautiful moment is that this son lied. This son deceived his father. This son was wearing his brother's clothes. This son covered his hands with goat's hair. This son covered his neck with goat's hair and made a pot of food and brought new wine to his father to deceive him. What kind of son must you be? And I'm going to go a few scriptures before that. Then he came to his father, and his father said, here I am. And his father asked, who are you, my son? Can you imagine that you come to your dad and he has to ask you who you are? You know, when a parent brings their children near, they don't have to ask who this is. They know. Now, the truth is that his father, his sight has gone. But his other senses were working just fine. Jacob said this to his father, I am Esau, your firstborn. Just like that. He lies. I have done as you told me. Second lie. Please get up and eat of my game. Firstly, it wasn't even game, it was goat's meat. Bless me. And Isaac said to Sarah, how is it that you have so quickly, have done this all so quickly, my son? Now listen, here's a father about to bless his son. And immediately he's going, something's not right here. I've asked you to go and hunt it, get some game, and make me some stew that tastes like the way you always make it. And how is it that you pack so quickly and you already prepared the meal? Because the Lord your God caused it to happen to me, Elijah. Now here's another lie. God, help me do it. You know, I don't know about you, but this son is wicked. Firstly, he's lying about who he is. He's deceiving his father, and now he's even saying God's in this plan. And then Isaac said to his son, please come close that I may feel you, my son. Whether you really are Esau. Now listen, Here's an old man who cannot see, and he's convinced that something fishy is going on here. Now, I don't know if he wanted to smell the sea, if he smelled fishy, but he wanted to bring it here, so that it's probably. And I believe deep down, this father knew something was happening here. And this child, whilst he made the first move to make the decision to lie, what was birthed out of this is that he asked his father to pass on to him the blessing of the eldest son. He did not recognize him because his hands were hairy like Esau's. So he blessed him. But before he blessed him, one last time, he asked, "Are you really my son, Esau?" And he said these words. Listen to the words. "I am. I am. Yahweh." The extent that he went to deceive his father, to get what wasn't his to have. He pushed him. He lied and cheated. Yes, he was even assisted by his mother in this great deception. And in the end, he received the blessing. You see, the Father in heaven sees everything. He is Al-Roi, the God who sees. He sees everything. He knows everything about him. While Isaac himself was a man and had the potential to not know things, and he was old and was aging, he couldn't trust his senses. He knew, however, in his spirit that something was right. But because his son proceeded to push into that deception, he eventually blessed him. And by the way, when he blessed him, he prayed a blessing over him that was generational, a blessing that was for him, his family, his children, and his children's children. It changed the nation that was to come out of him. And here was a man who was speaking to a son who understood what sacrifice meant. Here was a man whose father laid him on the altar. Here was a man who one day walked up a mountain with his dad, carrying the very wood that he would lay his life down. When Isaac had his day with his father, when he had his moment with his father, he walked up the hill carrying the wood for the sacrifice. And when he got to the place that was earmarked for them to build an altar, they built the altar with the wood that he carried. And his father laid him on the altar, on the wood, and was about to take a flint knife, which was normally used for sacrificing of animals or the circumcision of young men, a knife used for covenant, and was about to slit his throat when the angel of the Lord appeared before them and said, "Do not kill the boy." That boy that we refer to is the man who is now talking to his son. The man who understood what it is to lay down your life and to trust that God is able to take your life and give it back. Because the Lord said, "Through this boy, I will bless you." And so Abraham knew that even if he sacrificed his child, that the God that he was sacrificing his son to had the potential to raise him up again. Because he was going to do it through this son. So there was no way that God could say to him, "Lay down that child's life," and not believe that he would raise it up again. Because there was no other way that God could keep his promise through that son unless he did that. So Abel believed in the resurrection. Isaac understood sacrifice in a very different way. Because when the angel of the Lord appeared and took Abram and said to him, "Stop, don't kill the boy, I have provided ram. They found a ram in the end. God gave them a ram. Isaac understood what it is to lay down your life and have someone else die in your place. Something else die in your place. And it is in that context, and the only time this name of God is used. It's only used once in Scripture. It is one of the most overused names of God. But it is only used once in Scripture. It's where that ram is found in the bush. And Abram says, Yahweh Yireh, Jehovah Jireh, God provides. God provides a lamb. God provides a sacrifice. God provides a door. God provides a way. Isaac understood what it was like to have your life redeemed. So he understood God's provision. That God would provide a ram. That God would provide a lamb. He understood God's promise. He understood that God is true to his word. That God said, even though your father was willing to lay down your life, know this today, I have made a way. And you will receive everything that I have promised your father. God is not a God who turns back on his word. He can be trusted to do exactly as he said he would do. And when his father blessed the wrong son, God honored that prayer. God not only honored that prayer for that generation, but he honored that prayer for all generations. And the truth of the matter is, whilst there was a great deception that had taken place, Jacob deceived his brother to receive what his brother gave him illegally. Isn't it amazing? He prepared a meal for his father, and he prepared a meal for his brother. And all it cost for him to get all the inheritance was to make two meals. One for his brother, who scorned his birthright, for a plate of lentil soup. I don't know if you've ever been so hungry that you would give up anything to have something to eat. But I want to say, if you've never been at the point where you're happy to give up everything for a plate of food, then you don't know what it is to be hungry. When you see children not have the strength to knock away a fly because they haven't eaten for months, and that the food they must be given must be liquid form because they don't have the strength to chew. Unless you know what it's like to be hungry from the point where you feel like turning stone to bread, when you have been like Jesus in the wilderness for 40 days, not eating nor drinking, and the enemy comes to you, turn the stone to bread. And he said, you will not put the Lord your God to the test. You know, when the Lord quoted from the book of Deuteronomy, as he spoke about it, you know, the world sings the song, as God has shown us by turning stone to bread. That's a lie. Jesus did not turn the stone to bread. He embraced taking upon himself the sin of the world. And he made the decision when he was tempted by the enemy to bow down. So many will bow down to many things. But we need to realize that God has made a way for us. And there is a meal that has been prepared for us. And so we don't have to give away our birthright for a meal, but we can come to his table. He says, I've given you grain and new wine. And you know the thing, the symbol of the grain and the new wine is, with the grain you make the bread, and with the new wine, we have the wine of the new covenant. So you know, when Jesus was talking about the kingdom of God, and he tells the story of two sons. Matthew put two sons, very specific sons, that he was referring to. The one who despised his birthright, and the one who, through youthful exuberance, was prepared to do anything to have his inheritance. Two sons. Yes, he squandered his inheritance, that son. But the father had a heart for him. You know, there's this thing, because in the patriarchal society that Jesus was living in, people had a lot of time for the firstborn, but God's firstborn, the eldest son of God, the only begotten child of God, was willing to put his life on the very cross that he carried up the hill. And God did not spare him. For what Abram believed, God would do for Isaac, the Father did for our Lord Jesus Christ. Where Isaac, God made a way, and the provision was made. In Jesus, he drank the cup. He drank the cup that was prepared for him. And then he said these words, "This cup represents the new covenant that is in my blood." So today, as we prepare to eat a meal, the meal that has been prepared has been paid for in full. The meal that we are about to enjoy has been laced with suffering and pain. The meal that we are about has been pressed down, shaken together, squeezed out till the life ran out of his bones. For God did not spare his son. For just as Abram believed God was able to do, he was able to raise him up again. You see, God is not fearful of death. God embraces the journey of death. For he gave death as a form of healing to the whosoever shall believe. And if you're sitting here this morning and you are fearful of death, we no longer are slaves to fear. We are children of the living God. And Christ, who laid down his life, who carried the very wood up the hill and was nailed to it, laid down his life that we can embrace by eating the bread and drinking from the cup. This new covenant we celebrate, for unless we eat his flesh and drink his blood, we can have part of him. And so while we have made the table to represent so many different things, this morning I want you to see that even though a young man deceived his father, we need to recognize that that's not the whole story, and I'm only focusing on one aspect of the story. Yes, God had to speak to him in a dream. God spoke to him in a dream. His brother was the hunter and he was the shepherd. And when he laid down his head and had a dream and he saw heaven open and the angels coming down up the ladder, he rested in the place and he said, "Surely God is in this place." And he called it Bethel, the place of prayer, the place of God's presence. Isn't it amazing that when God announced the coming of the Son, heavens opened up and angels came singing glory and they descended? And isn't it amazing that they didn't go to the king, but they went to the shepherds? Our God is consistent in everything that he does. So the story of the kingdom of God is a story of those who would be children, those who would become sons, those who are willing to take hold of the inheritance that is yours in Jesus Christ. When you are willing to do the thing that God has called you to do, yes, he will look at your heart. People will look at the outside actions. God is looking at your heart. And even though there was a deceptive heart in Jacob, God was willing to see what extent he was willing to go to take hold of what was promised to him when his brother sold his birthright. Let me tell you something. God loves children who push into his promises. God loves his children to press into his presence. And he'll come and he'll meet with you. And you know what? You will wrestle with him and he will give you a limp and he will change you. No, God didn't let him get away with it. God changed him. God changed him. Physically changed him. He wrestled with God all night and came out with a limp. But I can tell you, he came out knowing what it was like to wrestle with God. And when you wrestle with God, there's only one winner. There's only one winner. But you know what? Because he wins, you win. Because you know what? What Jacob got was a transformation of who he was. From being a deceiver, from being a liar, a cheat, and a thief. He came and became the father of many nations. And through him, all the nations of the earth was to be blessed. Every nation on the earth is to be blessed. And so we bless him. For those who bless him shall be blessed. And those who curse him shall be cursed. And that's the prayer that was prayed over him. It wasn't prayed over a country. It was prayed over a man. I'm going to repeat that. It wasn't prayed over a country. It was prayed over a man. And the Lord named him Israel. We need to pray for the children of God like Israel, who will wrestle with God, who will press into God, who will take hold of the promises of God and the nature of God, and allow God to transform us from deceivers and liars and cheats and thieves into children of God, who carry the promise of God to the nations of God. For the whole earth shall be covered with his glory. The earth and the fullness thereof remains the Lord's. And he is making a way for all of us to come into his presence. So as we take of the bread and drink of the cup, may we recognize the prayer that was prayed over Jacob. May you be blessed. And may those who bless you be blessed. And let those who curse you, let the same curse they speak over you before them. Wow! That your Father will have your back to the extent that what your enemies plan to do to you shall befall them. I love my Father. I love that he has my back. And I love that he has called us to do this thing. If I can ask the stewards to come forward.